Welcome to PayPod, the show that features thought-provoking interviews with leaders and entrepreneurs in the payments and financial technology industries. From credit card processing to Bitcoin, we cover it all. So if you want to know what's happening right now in the payments industry, stay tuned. Now, here's your host, Scott Hawksworth.
Hey, PayPod listeners, Scott here, and welcome to yet another episode of PayPod, the Payments Podcast. We have got just a fantastic show for you today, which is the first of what I hope will be a number of episodes that are focusing in on e-commerce. If you're offering merchant services, curious about the world of payments, or just like learning about fintech, e-commerce businesses often intersect with all three of these things. And so to me, it's important to know how e-commerce merchants operate their businesses, their keys to success, and even some of the pain points they have when it comes to accepting credit cards and other forms of payment. And lastly, I must confess, as someone who has the entrepreneurial gene, I just find it fascinating to learn about how others approach their businesses. So with all of this in mind, I'm so happy to introduce our guest for this show. His name is Trevor Fenner, and he, along with his partner Juliana, founded a site and business called eCommerce Paradise, which is all about helping high-ticket drop shipping businesses grow their sales and so much more. Trevor, welcome to the show.
Yeah, thanks a lot for having me on. Happy to be here.
So to start us off, Trevor, can you just tell us a little bit about your journey into the world of e-commerce coaching? How'd you end up starting eCommerce Paradise? And what's your story?
Great. Yeah. Been doing e-commerce for the last decade or so. First got started selling on eBay all the way back in my senior year of high school. And going out of eBay, I started working on other platforms like WordPress, WooCommerce. I started actually doing drop shipping when I discovered the business model back when I had a day job a long time ago. And I wanted to get a way out of the day job. So I started figuring out what I could sell online. I found at the time, this was around 2010, that bicycles were actually really, really profitable. They still are, but back then it was just a very trendy thing. And so me and a business partner decided to go in on a business together. And we started an e-commerce store, drop shipping bicycles. We actually went and found suppliers that stocked the products in warehouses in the US. And we put up an e-commerce store, drove traffic, and took the payments by PayPal or through credit card, Stripe, and whatnot, and shipped the product to the customer. The customer got it. We would keep about maybe a 10 or 15% profit. And that was it. It was pretty good. And we scaled that like crazy. We ended up selling that store a few years later and starting some new ones. We've sold a bunch of stores since then. So I decided, you know, why not start teaching people how to do what I'm doing? Because I've really come to create a really great system process for doing this sort of business model now. And it's worked out great for me over and over again. So it's repeatable. And so now that's how I teach people is how to do that.
So basically you decided, hey, this 9-to-5 thing, I want to find something else. And then you found a product, you built a site, and you found all the things you needed to be successful with it. And you did that a few times. And then you kind of took all of these lessons. And then you're like, hey, let me spread the wealth of knowledge here. And that's what you're doing now. That's amazing.
Absolutely. And it's just like you said, it's like helping other people become successful with this model more than they are. Because I find that what is happening is that a lot of people will go and search out like how to do drop shipping or what it is and whatnot. And they go to YouTube or they go to Google and they start finding a lot of information on different ways to do it. And a lot of it's kind of okay, but it's not really optimized. It's not really teaching the right ways to do stuff. A lot of the things that are really advanced, like Google Shopping Ads or email marketing, that stuff isn't really gone into depth by the gurus that are out there, because unfortunately that stuff is actually kind of the secret sauce to making this stuff really profitable. And what I've been doing over the last 2 or 3 years since I've become quite successful with this stuff, been able to travel abroad and live in a location independently and make lots of money doing this, is that I've been helping people along the way anyways. I do this just out of the goodwill. I mastermind with a lot of different people that do this kind of stuff, and I love helping people. So it was a total passion project of mine in the beginning. And I started listening to Russell Brunson's podcast and read .com Secrets, Expert Secrets, and a ton of other internet marketing stuff. And I decided, why not build a whole nother business out of teaching people how to do this? And it's worked out great. And people are getting tons of value and have lots of awesome case studies already. Ready, and I'm excited to grow it and help more people.
Fantastic. And you also host a companion podcast to your site. I'm curious, what sorts of things do you cover on that show?
the podcast is kind of where it all started. And that was just out of my love to share things on the internet. And I realized that a lot of people that are trying to get out of their 9-to-5, trying to build a business, those people listen to podcasts. You know, I remember thinking back to when I was first getting started and all I did was listen to audiobooks and podcasts when I was in my car on the way to work, on the way home, or even going, you know, for me skateboarding or going for a bike ride, I would just listen to podcasts all day long and audiobooks, and having somebody in my ear talk about how to be successful, telling their stories about their failures or, you know, about their successes and stuff like that really got me going. I remember back in 2016, when I was still kind of struggling a little bit, I was trying to drive for Uber and Lyft, and I would actually keep an earbud in my left ear while I was driving the car around for people. And sometimes I'd have conversations, but when I didn't, it was great because I could just listen to podcasts the whole night. I would drive nights, and it just kept me going, got me excited, got me motivated. And yeah, I just really grew that fire, that flame. So when I got home, I would just jump into doing work, you know, just super excited about it.
Hey, as a fellow podcaster, that's a great story because podcasts are awesome.
I agree 100%.
So today I want to pick your brain a bit about e-commerce and specifically in the high ticket drop shipping world, which, you know, your whole site is about and those kinds of things. For those in the payments world who are listening and they may have merchants in this field looking for credit card processing, can you share what kinds of businesses tend to fall under this high ticket drop shipping e-commerce platform? You know, you mentioned bikes earlier. What kinds of other products are being sold by students of yours?
Yeah, sure. It's interesting how many different product categories there are out there once you start diving into it. But if you just think of anything that's over a few hundred dollars, that's considered high ticket. So if you just like what I usually do, for instance, on my YouTube videos, on my channel, I just go and show people different categories that are on Amazon or Wayfair, and a lot of things that are in the home, a lot of sporting goods categories, many, many things are over $300. You'd be blown away. But the key is that it has to be also something that isn't too blown out by big name brands. And so what I usually look at a lot is generic type of products, a lot of different home furnishings. You know, we're looking at different cabinetry products, you know, couches, you know, dining room tables, appliances like espresso machines, appliances like wine coolers, sporting goods, like I was talking about bicycles, but certain types of bicycles like fixed gear bicycles or electric bicycles, scooters, those types of things. There's tons of different categories. And so high ticket just basically is targeting one of these categories. And what we do that's very unique is we build out niche specific stores, which basically means single product category stores, which basically means you have a foundation of one category. And then as you build the store out, as you build the business, you go a little bit wider into categories that make sense, but you go as deep as possible into one specific category as you can. So you kind of build an authority business around that. And that's what consumers really want. Consumers want to be on a website that has the best information for that product. And they want to know they're dealing with somebody that can give them the best support after the sale. And that's what an authority business can do for that consumer. So that's why we do it that way.
Absolutely. And that makes so much sense. I mean, we're in the Amazon world now, and there's so many things that you can get there. But especially if you're getting some of these items, the authority with, hey, I'm going to this website now that is focused around this. They know what this product is, and that's all they do. There's a level of comfort there, especially when you're buying something online, right?
100%. And people, they want to know if they're buying from a small business that they're going to get treated like they're the best customer that business ever had. You know, if you go to Amazon, you shop, a lot of people
your number.
Yeah, exactly. And there's not even a phone number to call, really. And if you do, you're not going to get someone online who's an expert. You're going to get someone who might be able to help you figure out the website or something like that, navigate the website. But if you have a specific product question, you're going to have to enter it into the Q&A's box and hope that that vendor that actually sells that product or one of the retailers that's an authorized retailer for the product will answer that question back. But there's not going to be a phone number you can call. So if something goes wrong, the product gets damaged on delivery, there can be a lot of issues trying to reach out to the actual retailer. Because if you go on Amazon and you search for expensive products, a lot of times you'll notice Amazon does not actually sell those products. They're only sold by third-party marketplace sellers. And that's because Amazon doesn't want to take the liability for the product, which makes sense. and Amazon passes on the liability to the third-party marketplace seller, which is usually a company that also has their own e-commerce business, and if they don't, then they should, but that's how it works. So you might as well go to these authority sites and buy directly from them anyways. Usually you'll find a live chat box. Usually you'll be able to get on the line with an actual expert customer service rep. So
just to connect that to what we do here at SOAR Payments, that's one of the things we try to offer, you know, beyond something like a Stripe, where they do great work, but you don't really get anybody on the phone if you've got a problem. And sometimes for some of these businesses, they may don't understand them as well. So I think there is a lot to be said about that specialization when it comes to any sort of business. Now, I'm curious, what are some of the biggest challenges that folks either starting or trying to grow these type of e-commerce businesses face? Is it just a matter of, you know, marketing and traffic, or are there other difficult parts of the business that they need to navigate?
Yeah, and I wanted to kind of approach this from the perspective of the listeners of the podcast, because I think there are some really unique problems that e-commerce store owners, especially in the high ticket realm, encounter that not every other e-commerce store really has to deal with. And specifically, one of them is accepting credit cards and not getting frauded on that. So we have to deal with that a lot. We actually use third-party fraud prevention apps. The one we use is ClearSale. There's also other ones available. One's called Signified. And what they do is they look at the transaction. They do background checks on the actual person who placed the order. They check their phone number and they check email address and they check the data about the person to see if everything matches up. They kind of cross-check them online. And they figure and they make sure that that person is actually a real person. And then if there is actually a fraud that happened and they covered it, and they basically will pay you out on that loss. And so far, since we've been using them, we've never had a single fraud order. Whereas before we started using them, I actually did deal with some fraud that cost us thousands of dollars. So we definitely use that now. Yeah, it's an issue, you know, you have to deal with that sometimes.
Absolutely. And I mean, when you are dealing with these high ticket items, it's not a $9 charge that, you know, wouldn't be great if there was some fraud, but still not quite as punishing. So that shows how important that is, right?
And it's also a bigger deal in product categories where they're easily resold. Like I used to sell these electric scooters, and it's a unique, trendy kind of product. If you were to take that and put it on Craigslist, you could probably easily resell it, maybe about $1,500 a pop, you know? So we actually got frauded out on two of those a few years back. And it was kind of a big eye-opener that, you know, the guy actually had called on the phone and it was totally normal sounding person. And the only thing that was off a little bit was that he needed things in a hurry and he was looking for two, not just one. And there were these little kind of telltale signs that later on in retrospect, I realized I should have been probably taking my time and said, no, you know, unfortunately we cannot do 2-day shipping, that kind of stuff. We have to double check your background first and all that. But since I've learned that lesson, you know, now we understand kind of telltale signs of fraud, and we look out for it. It's really important.
Absolutely. Now, I think you touched on this earlier a little bit, but I've got to dive in. You know, this is a payments show. What sort of payment setup do you tend to recommend e-commerce business owners pursue? And does it vary based on their product, or do you have, you know, a stack you might recommend specifically, be it Stripe, PayPal, or even, you know, getting a payment gateway and setting up a merchant account with someone like us here at SOAR Payments? What do you usually recommend?
Sure. So this also can depend whether you're a US-based business or whether you're an internationally-based business, because USA-based businesses have access to certain services that aren't available to international businesses. So I deal with some international clients sometimes, specifically like Singapore, Malaysia, in parts of Europe, Canada, of course. And so there's certain things you cannot do in certain countries. For instance, with Shopify, Shopify Payments does not work for people that are outside of the US, I believe. For my students that I've had to help, they have to actually set up a separate Stripe account and connect Stripe to Shopify separately as a separate payment method. And that's worked fine. Not 100% sure if there's extra fees or not. And if I'm wrong about that Shopify payments thing, hopefully one of your listeners will correct me. But as far as I know, you do have to do that. But what they are able to do still is set up PayPal. So we always set up PayPal separately, because I think honestly, PayPal is world recognized. Consumers use it now, thanks to the work that eBay's done to brand it and to spread it so much. PayPal is now definitely something that almost everybody has an account with. And even if they don't, they can use their credit card to use through PayPal anyways. And PayPal also offers seller protection, which is really nice, and buyer protection and financing as well. So it's really cool to have that.
Absolutely. So PayPal, connecting Stripe with Shopify payments and things like that. Is there anything else that you, you know, you've encountered in terms of payments or helped, you know, one of your students navigate?
Yeah. And the other thing I'll talk about is financing, because PayPal offers financing. The issue is that you'll never know if that consumer actually used PayPal financing. They don't tell you that. All you'll know is that they paid through PayPal unless the consumer actually tells you, hey, I financed it through PayPal. I have some questions. But financing is key. And we use a separate financing company besides PayPal just because they offer better term, well, longer terms specifically, like 12 months or 24, or 36 month financing. And for like a $3,000 or $5,000 product, or you know, even more, if you're selling business to business or business to government, these kinds of things can really help close those sales. So we use a company called Klarna, and Klarna is just one of them. There's many other financing companies, but a company like Klarna will offer longer financing options. Of course, there's going to be a percentage associated with that, maybe close to like 10% sometimes. It depends on the person and their credit score and stuff like that. But with PayPal, they offer a 0% if paid in full in 6 months plan, which is kind of cool. So consumers tend to take one or the other, but they still have to apply. They still have to get approved for it. And it depends on their credit and all that. But it really does help us. Like, we used to sell mobility scooters. That was one of the very profitable stores we had. Not too long ago, actually, we sold that store. And it's an older niche. It's a market where you have consumers between 65 and 85 on average. So it's older people. And surprisingly, a lot of them actually don't have the kind of cash on hand to afford these things. Yet they actually really almost need them, if not just like, yeah, would really, you know, improve their livelihood by getting out and using them. So we found that financing was almost critically required on that store to be profitable. And I would say a good third of our orders came through financing. And funny enough, a lot of them would actually call on the phone. Whereas, you know, some niches, you don't barely take phone calls, but mobility scooters, you're dealing with old people, and old people love to talk on the phone, right? So we were taking phone calls all the time. And a lot of them would try to place their financing orders through us, which we can't do. So we'd have to kind of guide them on how to use a computer to place the order online. And that was a funny, interesting process too.
Again, this is such a great thing. This is why I'm so glad I've brought you on here, because I wasn't even considering something like financing. And of course, that's something that merchants like yourself in high ticket spaces would need to consider. So that's huge. My last follow-up, as we're talking about payments, I'm curious, have you seen any folks run into problems with processing due to the size of their high ticket sizes, how much they're trying to charge for each, or the types of products that they're selling, you know, that either Stripe doesn't want to work with, or there's a problem with PayPal? And I'm curious, if so, how have they navigated it?
Yeah, that's an interesting question. It does happen sometimes. The one thing that I've noticed a lot is for new sellers specifically, when you first get started and you first open either a Shopify Payments or Stripe account and you get your first order, maybe it's $1,000 or $2,000 or somewhere in that range is, you know, the average. What'll happen is they'll actually flag your account and they'll ask for a lot of verifying documents, because $1,500 is, you know, quite a bit of money. And if you happen to be some sort of a person, you know, located in Africa or India or something like that, and you're just trying to defraud the system, you could possibly get that money in your checking account, remove it immediately, and then just disappear overnight. And so Shopify Payments now is quite smart, and they've realized that, and I'm sure this has probably happened to them. That's why they're doing this. They've been doing it for a while, but they'll actually flag the account. They won't send you the money to your checking account until you provide them with the actual ID and either your passport or your state issued ID. And then they'll ask for your supplier contracts, your invoice, your checking statement. I believe there's a bunch of different things, links to your social media accounts, or many things that they ask for. So it's kind of a pain point for the seller, but it's just kind of a necessary thing to protect, obviously, the payment process. I don't believe I've ever dealt with that from Stripe personally, but then again, with Stripe, I have a long history on my account. So again, it probably depends on the history of your account. If it's a brand new account, you're going to deal with that. If you had the account for a long time and you have a history of processing orders and very low chargebacks, you're probably not going to deal with it. But if you start getting more chargebacks and stuff like that, that's probably going to raise a flag for them as well. So,
yep. Then you got to call us.
Yeah, exactly. Have SorPay on your speed dial.
On your speed dial. I'm curious, Trevor, what are your thoughts on e-commerce businesses accepting alternative forms of payment beyond credit cards or ACH? I'm curious if you think it's worthwhile for businesses to pursue things like cryptocurrencies. And I'm curious, why or why not?
I do. I think it's awesome. The only thing about it is that, generally speaking, when it comes to conversion optimization, less is more. And so when I'm looking at any part of the website, any part of the funnel, I'm thinking, how can I minimize and simplify and yet completely focus their attention on one goal? So I'm looking at, what is the number one payment method people are always going to be paying with? It's either going to be with a credit card or with their PayPal account usually. So that's what I have on my stores. Now, I know that other people have stores that are offering payment by Bitcoin or payment by through Amazon Pay. And there's the financing as well, but it's growing, I think. And over time, cryptocurrency is going to evolve and it's going to become more mainstream. And it's going to, generally speaking, equalize and level out and be more accepted by consumers. And so all that really has to happen is there needs to be sort of the same level of trust established with all these different cryptocurrency methods. How would you call them? Like, basically trusting that the money that you have today is going to be the same today as it is tomorrow. You're not going to wake up and all your money's gone. So that's the biggest issue I think that people have right now with holding cash in crypto. And so when you have cash in crypto, the generally as a business, the thing is that you want to do is change it to USD as quickly as possible just to protect yourself. And the only reason is because the US dollar is still accepted worldwide as the main currency. And of course, it's just a fiat currency, but still it's based on people's belief that it's going to be the same tomorrow as it is today. And eventually crypto will get there as well. I do believe that.
Absolutely. And just a little anecdote for folks listening. Just this past Saturday, I was walking and I went to get some sushi for lunch here downtown Chicago. And right there on the front of the door, it said, "We accept Bitcoin." So it's coming is what my point is.
I think you made a really good little point there, though. I want to elaborate on that, is that when you can use crypto in physical places, I think that's going to really greatly enhance the amount of people that actually start using it. And just the fact that you can walk around and have your smartphone with your digital wallet on it, present it to a vendor and get your coffee in crypto or get your lunch in crypto or whatever it is. I mean, it's just such a quick way to transact money, and it's easy and it's convenient. And e-commerce takes it, your local merchant takes it, why not have it? You know, it just makes sense. So I think we'll get there eventually.
You know, I want to move on here to talk about something that I think a lot of e-commerce merchants worry about, and that is cart abandonments. And I think a lot of this also intersects with payments and things like that. You know, they want to make sure that their customers have a smooth experience on site. They want to make sure that they, when they get that shopping cart full, they're completing the process. What advice might you have for business owners who want to excel in this user experience area and reduce cart abandonment and things?
Cart abandonment is definitely one of the biggest issues. Luckily, there are automations that you can come up with to greatly enhance the opportunities you have there. Obviously, if somebody's gone through the checkout process, entered their contact information, and gotten to the last stage of checkout and then dropped out, they're very likely to buy. They're probably price shopping, or maybe it just wasn't the right moment of the day. I think the number one key is follow-up. So if somebody's entered that much information into your website, you've got to follow up with them. You've got to follow up by email. And email is obviously like the first thing you can do in an abandoned cart email sequence. I recommend having a probably 5 to 10 email series set up, follows up within the first few hours, and then again in the first like 6 to 12 hours, and again one day, second day, third day, follow up at least once every single day, because you just never know. Like maybe they didn't have the money, or they just weren't ready, or maybe they didn't quite know you well enough or trust you, or maybe they were trying to find a better deal somewhere else and something happened. You know, life always happens. So people have many different reasons for not closing the deal out when they first started. So follow-up is key. You can do it by email. You can also do it by phone call. If it's a high ticket sale, there's probably a few different reasons, and you can have a VA or just do it yourself and actually call the phone number they put into the checkout screen and see if they answer. Sometimes people don't, but when they do answer, they're probably going to be pretty surprised. Actually, I've gotten a phone call from you. I know if you go to Amazon and try to check out, no one's going to call you back. So it again adds to that sort of small business experience, which is really cool. And again, like with the payments thing, I think just having enough payment options for people to check out whichever way they want to is key. You know, if somebody has a PayPal account and you have PayPal offered, great. If somebody needs financing, you have financing that offered and they get approved for it, great. You know, and if somebody has a credit card, you know, you don't for some reason take credit cards. That makes no sense. But maybe for instance, they have a gift card and they wanted to pay by gift card or something like that. You know, just having the options available for them to check out in whatever way they needed is important. And of course, asking people. If you just ask them, say, "Hey, why didn't you check out? Was it an issue with this or that? Could you help us out?" We always do that in our email sequences. You can do that by phone. just trying to figure that out. And then we always use an app on Shopify called Lucky Orange. And Lucky Orange is really cool because it will show you kind of an over the shoulders perspective of that person's shopping experience through your store. So you can see where they were on the product page, where they were maybe browsing through collections, and then on the cart page and whatnot. And maybe it'll give you an idea of that person, what they were looking for and what kind of things they kind of got hung up on maybe. And you know, and then that can lead you into thinking, how can I improve my store? How can I improve the product page? How can I improve the cart page? Maybe if something popped up, you know, and they got weirded out and they clicked out of there, maybe you can turn off that pop-up. So there's many different things you can look at using that app. And we like to do that a lot. We also use it for heat maps, which is really cool to see where people are actually clicking on the store. So you can sort of direct people's attention more towards the things that are getting clicked and less away from the things that aren't going to get ignored. And again, going back to the simplification thing, store optimization is all about simplification and directing people's attention towards what you want them to do. So if there's like five checkout buttons on the cart page, they're going to look around and say, which one am I supposed to click? So just have one checkout button, you know,
right.
It just makes sense. And maybe even have an arrow pointing to that checkout button. Hey, you're ready to place your order, click here, you know, and people, they like that because it makes it easier for them to figure out where to go, you know, just put a sign up, click here, go. Cool.
For sure. As an entrepreneur myself, I'm curious, what sort of system do you tend to recommend for mailing people? Is it MailChimp or, you know, Infusionsoft or what?
Yeah, so it depends on your business model, you know, and we do drop shipping and e-commerce through Shopify. And the best one that links up with Shopify and works with other apps like AfterShip for physical product e-commerce is Klaviyo. So Klaviyo is really nice because it has built-in flows and they're templated out. And so you can set them up really easily. And then with the AfterShip stuff, you can set up templates for when the product is shipped out and then for when it's out for delivery and then when it's for delivered. So you can send a different series of emails. You know, if it's just being shipped out, hey, you know, I just want to let you know it's being shipped out and this is the process. Because a lot of high-ticket items are really big and they require freight shipping, which, you know, is a whole process because you have to order the freight, takes a few extra days. You have to actually call the customer. The freight company calls the customer prior to delivering the product from the local warehouse. And then, you know, usually there's a lift gate involved if it's a residential address, or maybe if it's a business, they drop at the dock, but still the customer has to receive it at the curbside. And then they can either move it in themselves or they can hire the white glove delivery service to bring it in for them and set it up and assemble it, whatever it happens to be. But that requires a little bit extra communication to tell them what the process is going to be. And Klaviyo allows that by working in certain flows via other apps like AfterShip to alert the customer, let them know. Otherwise, the customer never knows, or we have to call them and explain to them every single customer every single time what's going to happen. And it's such a pain, you know, so it really, really helps automate the process.
Absolutely. And this is reminding me about a month ago, I bought an elliptical trying to get back in shape in the new year, right? And that's exactly what happened. You know, they had a whole service for delivery and I ended up getting the, you know, the turnkey service where they brought it upstairs and assembled it and everything like that. And I had a separate shipping company call me and say, hey, when can we deliver this and all that kind of stuff. So very, very interesting. I'm curious, what's the biggest mistake either you've made or you've seen made with e-commerce businesses like those of your students? And how can that mistake, that misstep be avoided?
Yeah, I would definitely say not putting effort into content marketing. I think it's the number one key for e-commerce is content. So content marketing is a whole plethora of different things. But the number one place to focus on your content, especially with high ticket dropshipping, because what we're doing is we're searching for shoppers who are price shopping around, those kind of bottom of the funnel, low hanging fruit shoppers. They're just looking for the best deal, the website with the best content. Focus on the product page. The product page is where the money's made. So, you know, you have to focus on optimizing the sales page, and you have to put lots of pictures in there because people buy products based on the pictures. So make sure there's plenty of high quality images in the upper left of the screen like there usually is, but also work them into the product description. Make a really good description that doesn't just talk about features, but talks about the actual lifestyle benefits you get from those features. And the way I like to come up with that is just using the word so. You would have the feature and then put the word so in there and then have the benefit after that. This mobility scooter is going to go 20 miles per hour so that you can, you know, really enjoy the cool breeze on your face as you're riding down the sidewalk, that kind of thing, because people want to understand the experience they're going to have that product is going to give them. And that's truly what you're doing for them, is you're fulfilling a desire, solving a problem. So work that into your product descriptions. And then have all your different policies and stuff like that in your description. Don't just have them on separate pages, like your shipping policy, return policy, warranty, all that stuff. Many e-commerce stores just have them kind of hidden within their store. If you have it really simply laid out in the bottom of your product description, it's all going to be in one page. And I learned this from eBay, because a lot of sellers on eBay will work all these different policies into the actual product description, which is really smart, because they're shopping around, they land on the page, they don't want to have to click out to a million different pages and try to find stuff. So make it easy for them to shop and to buy. And then, of course, list your payment methods that you accept on your product page. I think that's really key, because if somebody lands in your store and they're kind of worried, oh, I don't know if they're going to take credit card, I don't know if they're going to take my PayPal, I don't know if they're going to have financing for me, let them know ahead of time, hey, we take all these credit cards, we accept PayPal, we have financing available, we accept cryptocurrency, whatever you happen to accept, make sure it's laid out there and put anything related to that or to the payments you accept close to the add to cart button. Because, you know, a product page can become really long, and the add to cart button is where you want to put all the stuff that they're going to want to know about actually placing that order. So if you center stuff around the add to cart button, I think it's really important. And, you know, make it easy to follow. Like I was saying before, just make it easy to find the add to cart button, make it easy to find that checkout button. And if somebody wants to order, they'll probably just go ahead and place their order. But focusing on content is definitely key.
Absolutely. You know, we've talked about content, but the next piece to that that we haven't touched on yet, and I have to, you know, so many businesses are trying to market out there. It's so difficult now. There is so much noise. How do you get the traffic? How do you get the attention? How do you beat out the Amazon or the big box store? Can you share any advice you'd have for increasing traffic and getting an e-commerce site in front of your target audience? Any channels that you think are particularly worth pursuing?
Yeah, sure. And it really depends on your business model. Again, like if you're selling cheap products as opposed to expensive products, it's a kind of a different gig altogether. Like for instance, a lot of people start out with AliExpress drop shipping from China, and they start with a $10 or $20 or $30 product, maybe like a free plus shipping offer. And that really thing requires a special type of traffic, and that's Facebook ads. Because with Facebook ads, you can target specific interest groups. And since it's such a low dollar purchase, you can basically bank on the fact it's going to be an impulse buy decision. So if you make a really cool offer, an awesome product, and you have a really fun, exciting, attention-getting Facebook ad, chances are you'll make some sales. Of course, you're not going to be profitable until you have a lot of upsells built into your sales funnel, but that's a different model. So with high ticket drop shipping, the key is you have to understand these products are very expensive. And so the sales cycle is quite a bit longer. So it's most likely somebody who enters the sales cycle today and starts wondering, what types of ellipticals are out there? What brands are there? And, yep. And what model, you know, should I get? Which one's right for me? They're not going to go through that just from a Facebook ad, you know? So they're going to have to do some research. I don't know, how long did it take you to find out which one you wanted?
It took me definitely a few weeks. I even went to a site and added it to the cart, kind of going back to what we were talking about. And I didn't check out for another like 3-4 days because I wanted to be 100% sure. So I was doing research for a while.
Yeah, that's great that you remembered that. And a lot of people do the exact same thing. And it's the exact timeline, somewhere between a week to 3 weeks is what the sales cycle is. And of course, it's just because life gets in the way. You know, you want that thing, but there's a million other things to do. And then, you know, got some free time. Let me get back into the research for that. I really want that elliptical. I want to get fit, you know, something might remind you of it or whatever, you know. I think the key is with high ticket dropshipping is you want to target the people that have already been researching that quite a bit. I'm going to start this because in the very beginning, this is what you want to be doing. You want to get the low hanging fruit customers. And these are people that have done the research. They've already decided what brand they want. They've even decided what product they want. Now they're shopping around for price and for deal and to find a store that they trust. And again, kind of has that like small business feel to it. Somebody who is an expert who can really help them if something happens, right? And so what you need to do is use Google. Google is where people start when they are typing in keywords like products and stuff like that, or just looking for information. Google is no longer just a place where there are just articles showing up. Google is huge with e-commerce. Google Shopping specifically is a huge channel for e-commerce, whether it be something like $30 or something like $3,000. It's sold through Google Shopping. Google Shopping is simply just a marketplace, basically. Stores can put advertisements for their products in there, and Google will link to that advertiser, and the cost per click is somewhere between 30 cents and $3 on average for these products, right? So what I highly suggest doing is setting up Google Shopping ads in the very beginning. And the thing about Google Shopping ads that's really key to understand is that you cannot target keywords
with Google Shopping Ads. Google decides what keywords they show your ad for. And so with that said, it can be very difficult to do them profitably until you understand how negative keywords work and how to build out campaign funnels structured in such a way so that keywords filter through the funnels and you will bid much higher for actual product keywords instead of bidding high for generic product category keywords. Because if you bid $3 on Best Elliptical 2019, you're probably not going to get the sale because it's a 3-week cycle and you really have to do a lot of follow-up. And the problem is when that customer comes back to Google again and they type in an actual product name, like the brand name, the model name, the SKU number, the specific elliptical they want, you need to be there. You need to be up in that Google Shopping ad in the first to the third place. And if you're not, you're probably going to miss the sale. But if you are, they've already seen you since they were shopping that before, and they might've seen you before, and hopefully they've seen you before. But if they see you that next time when they're ready to order, that builds trust and builds the professional look of your business, they'll actually click through and most likely make that sale. So what I teach how to do is how to build out these campaign structures for high ticket stores. And it's something that it's taken me a good half decade to learn how to do properly. And now that I know how to do it, it's a lot easier to make these shopping campaigns very profitable because we're targeting buyer specific queries, which is really important to understand. But Google Shopping for high ticket is the number one sales channel that we have right now.
I love it. And just to underscore that, when I was buying that elliptical, I did start at Best Ellipticals like 2018 or whatever it was. Then I looked around and then I actually found one that a model that I was like, oh, I think this could work. And then I searched that specific model. And that's exactly what the process was. So,
and to kind of elaborate just a little bit more, Google Shopping Ads is where we get cold traffic and warm traffic, but you have to do retargeting. And retargeting is a big important thing because, of course, if somebody lands on your website and they don't see you ever again, that's not going to help build your professional look to them. So we retarget through Facebook advertising, we retarget through Google advertising and through emails. And you can also retarget through YouTube ads if that happens to be strong in your niche. You can even use things like Pinterest and Pinterest advertising. But the number one channel for advertising for retargeting is Facebook. Because people, at the end of the day, they're done shopping, they go back to Facebook. And then if they see you pop up in their Facebook feed randomly with a great offer, reminds you to come back to the site, it's just as powerful as an email in the inbox. We get a lot of different conversions just because we have our Google Shopping ad structure set up. They're ready to buy. Something happened. They had to close out their phone or they got distracted somehow. They go to their Facebook feed later on. We reminded them and they came back and bought. So it works really well.
Okay. So we've been talking about how things are now. We've been talking about what it's like here in 2019. Trevor, can you peer into the crystal ball? What do you see far off in the future when it comes to e-commerce? What new innovations, either in shopping carts, drop shipping, web design, the field as a whole, do you see, making huge impacts?
I love this question because it's always so much fun to talk about the future and all the cool things that are happening. I've always been a total tech geek and excited about what's going on in technology and how technology is evolving. And it's just amazing to see how quickly technology has evolved in the last 20 years or so, as opposed to, the whole 50 or 100 years before that. So with that being said, I think honestly, smartphone and mobile is going to just absolutely rule the e-commerce space as these mobile devices get faster and smarter, easier to use, and mobile browsers get better and apps get better. People are going to be able to do more on them than they already are. Shopping is just something that somebody does because they need it. It doesn't really matter what device they're on. The only reason somebody might use a computer instead of a mobile device is just because the screen is bigger. Maybe they use their computer at home or whatever, and again, it depends on the market. But I think honestly, mobile is just going to continue to grow and continue to evolve. It's already become the leader in search. It's already become the leader in e-commerce for sure. People buy things predominantly on their mobile devices now. So as an e-commerce entrepreneur, the listeners should really be focused on optimizing their businesses for mobile and whatever that means for them, just because that's going to take over, for the foreseeable future. And not just that, but also other really cool things that are evolving and becoming more and more used over time as technology improves, which things like augmented reality things like 3D printing devices are going to become more household items and more common. You're going to be able to order designs online in the future and print things at home that you weren't normally able to. Things that you have to buy online have shipped from, you know, wherever, like simple things like silverware or like homewares or mugs or whatever. Anything that could be built from a 3D printer, which actually is kind of expanding like crazy now.
Yeah.
You'll be able to buy your own 3D printer and just print your own stuff at home. You won't even have to order stuff online anymore. So that's going to become a lot more common.
It's going to be exciting to see for sure.
Totally.
Okay. So we have a segment that we like to end with where we do a fast five questions, rapid fire. Trevor, are you ready?
Ready as I'll ever be.
All right. So I asked you for the long prediction in the future. Now make a prediction about the future of e-commerce that you expect will happen in the next 12 to 24 months, near term.
I think a lot more entrepreneurs are going to start getting into e-commerce because you see these tech giants doing so much volume. And I keep getting people coming in to my sales funnel and asking me all sorts of questions like, oh man, like I wish I would have discovered you 3-4 years ago. And I'm thinking to myself, you know, the only reason they're hearing about me is because the media is putting so much more emphasis on e-commerce now. So e-commerce itself is evolving, but I think honestly, there's going to be a lot more entrepreneurs, which for the listeners, and you're thinking about getting into e-commerce, now's the time because a lot more people are going to get into e-commerce in the next couple of years, for sure.
What's one cool piece of technology unrelated to e-commerce that you've come across recently that impressed you?
I love technology and I'm always really impressed by the drones that are coming out nowadays. I think drone technology is just insane and it's going to get even cooler as time goes on. I cannot wait until I have my own personal drone that I can turn on and it'll fly me from one side of Bangkok to the other instead of having to sit through the traffic or take the train or whatever. I know it sounds sketchy and scary, but I honestly think little personal helicopter drones are going to be as common as cars in the next maybe few years, probably.
Wow, that'd be crazy. I think it'll also be interesting. Delivery drones and things like that, you know, order something then just buzzes in to your window and drops it off. I think all that's going to be cool.
I agree.
In the next 5 years, most Americans will make a purchase with either Bitcoin, Apple Pay, or some other thing. Which one and why?
Oh, Bitcoin for sure. I think honestly, like we were saying before, it just is going to take a lot more media attention. I think that there are some certain big players. Of course, you know, we're talking about a currency that goes totally against what the fiat currencies exist to do, which is control. It's going to be an interesting kind of struggle and sort of an underground that's going to lead this new system. But yes, of course, people will continue to use the US dollar and to process that money. But crypto is going to become much more mainstream in the coming years.
What's one piece of advice you would have for someone who's, you know, maybe they're listening to this and they're considering starting a high ticket drop shipping business?
I would say learn as much as possible because there's just so much out there. You need to be focused on learning. But the other thing is don't just learn, do. When I was going to college and I was taking business courses, I was doing my own e-commerce business on the side. And the number one thing I thought to myself every single day when I went to class for marketing or sales or whatever it was, is how can I apply this to my business? So yes, it costs a little bit of money to start up. Don't be afraid of the startup costs. It's a totally lean startup model compared to, you know, any kind of a physical storefront model or even starting like an info products business. And so just start a website. Choose a niche. Don't be afraid of failing because failure is part of the journey to success. And so if you're not failing, you're not going to become successful. Just understand that and accept that you're going to fall down along the way. Just get back up, laugh it off and try again. And listen, get your ego out of it. Don't go for the passion play. Don't pick a product because you like it. Pick it because it's profitable. That's the key here is you want to build a business. You don't want to just build another hobby, right? We're doing this for the money and to help people. So keep that in mind.
Last one. What is the best business advice you've ever received and from whom?
This, I'm going to probably go back all the way to when I first started listening to Tony Robbins. I used to listen to a lot of his audiobooks when I was going to college and stuff like that. I think the number one thing he said that really stuck out to me was a personal finance thing. And it was back in the day and it was spend less than you make. this is key because any business, anything in life, you have to learn to live below your means. So whatever your income happens to be, whatever your expenses happen to be, lower your expenses and work on raising your income. And if you happen to be in debt, you've got to pay off the debt first. It has an interest rate, right? And then you've got to raise your income and lower your expenses. It's just such simple logic. And yet I would say probably 90, 95% of people either just ignore the logic or they know it and they just don't do it, or they just don't really think about it too much and they just go out and spend money. So you have to keep track of it, make a budget for your personal life and for your business and keep track of that. And if you keep your books really well in your personal life, then you'll do well with your business. If you're not doing good at budgeting your personal life, you're probably not going to do very well with business. So learn how to do that in your personal life first. And then you'll probably be able to figure out business. But business isn't really going to work for you if you can't make it profitable. And profitability is all about income is exceeding your expenses.
Absolutely. Trevor, I wanted to thank you so, so much for joining me on the show today. This was a really, really great conversation.
Yeah, thank you, Scott, for having me. I really appreciate it.
If folks are listening and they want to connect with you, maybe check out some of your coaching, learn more, where should they go?
Sure. It's all available at ecommerceparadise.com. And if you want to check out the podcast specifically, I highly recommend that. We got tons of great episodes in there and interviews and lots of good things to come. Just type in ecommerceparadise.com/podcast. That'll forward to the iTunes store. You can subscribe right there on your smartphone.
Awesome stuff. Thanks again, Trevor.
Thank you, Scott.
Well, that's it for our show today. Thank you so much for listening. And if you like what we do here, don't forget to rate and review us on iTunes or whatever your preferred podcast listening platform is. We'll be back with another episode very soon.
Thank you for listening to another episode of PayPod, brought to you by Soar Payments. Soar Payments is a leading merchant services provider for e-commerce, high-risk, and hard-to-place businesses. If you'd like to get the latest PayPod episode sent to you automatically, subscribe to the show via iTunes or Stitcher, or visit soarpay.com/podcast.